Assalamu alaikum, brother. I'm Dr. Kamar Ara, and my question is, Christians explain the concept of Trinity as well as that God can take human form by giving the example that water can be present in three states, as solid like ice, liquid as water, and gas as vapor. Yet it is one and the same water. Similarly, a person can also be a father, a brother, a businessman at the same time, but yet he's the one and the same person. So why not the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit?
The sister asked the question regarding Trinity, if the Christians have the concept of Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. The previous question was, I proved it, that from the Bible, Jesus, peace be upon him, never believed in Trinity. Now she gave an example. She's giving a human logic, asking a question, that if water can be present in three states, as solid, liquid and gas, as ice, water and vapor, when water can be in three states, why can't God be? Similarly, the Christian missionaries pose the question, even God Almighty can be present in three forms, Father, Son and Holy Ghost. Now if you analyze, I do agree matter can be in three states, solid, liquid and gas. But you should realize that if water is present in three states, solid, liquid, gas, as ice, water and vapor, in all the three states, the constituent, the component of water is the same, H2O. Even if it's ice, the constituent and component is H2O. Even when it is water, it is H2O. Even when it is vapor, it is H2O. Even when it's ice, even when it is gas or liquid, it is H2O. That's very important. Now let's analyze the example they gave of Trinity, Father, Son and Holy Ghost. In three forms, if you say, for sake of argument, I agree. But are the constituent of all these three things, Father, Son, that is Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Holy Ghost the same? We know very well that human beings have got flesh and bone. A spirit and God Almighty has got no flesh and bone. Human beings require to eat. God Almighty does not require to eat. And the same message Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, gave, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 24, verse number 39 to 43, that, behold my hands and feet, it's I myself, handle me and see, that a spirit has got no flesh and bone, as you see me have. And he gave his hands and feet. And they were overjoyed. To prove what? That he was not a spirit. He was not God Almighty. And the verse continues, do you have meat to eat? And the next verse says that he ate broiled fish and honeycomb. To prove what? That he was God? To prove that he was not God. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, a spirit has no flesh and bone as I have. Proving that he was not a spirit, he was not Almighty God. Regarding the second example, sister gives the example that a person can be a father, a brother and a businessman at the same time. So why can't God be Father, Son and Holy Ghost? It's a very good example. And I do agree that one person can be a father, can be a brother and can be a businessman at the same time. Many people out here also may be father, brother and businessman at the same time. But if suppose the sister of that man tells a secret to the brother, but naturally, even the father and businessman will know that secret because one and the same person. If a sister tells a secret to the brother, who is a father and a businessman at the same time, when the secret is told to the brother, even the father part of that man and businessman part of that man will know that secret. But when you read in the Bible, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 13, verse number 32, it says, of that day, of that hour, knoweth no man, no, not even the angels in the heaven, nor the Son of Man, but the Father. The knowledge of the hour of that day, no one knows, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, except the Father, not even the angels, not even himself. If Father, that God Almighty, and Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, one and the same, then if knowledge of hour is known to God Almighty, even Jesus should know about it, peace be upon him. So this proves that they were not one. Further, if the brother dies, even the man and the businessman will die. If the brother dies, Even man and business will die. So when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Bible, according to the Christian, he died on the cross. Do you mean to say even God Almighty and the Holy Ghost died?
Assalamu alaikum. I am Riyaz Vadgaonkar and a businessman. So my question is, Allah is the most appropriate name for God. So besides Quran, is it mentioned in any other religious scriptures?
To respond the question that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained my talk, is an appropriate name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God. Is this name Allah mentioned anywhere else in the other religious scriptures? If you analyze most of the religious scriptures which have the concept of Almighty God, somewhere or the other, most probably, one of the attributes of God Almighty is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, if you read the Bible, in the Hebrew language, they call God Almighty as Elohim. Him is a sign of respect in the Semitic languages. So actually it is Elo. Elo for God. And if you read the Bible, Old Testament also, it says for God Elo or Ella. And in the English Bible, revised by Reverend Scofield, he gives the spelling of Ella as alternatively either as E-L or E-L-A-H or A-L-A-H. He pronounced as Ella. L, Ella or Ella. A-L-A-H. We Muslims, when we write in English Allah, we write A-L-L-A-H. But Reverend Scofield wrote A-L-A-H. They pronounce Ella, we pronounce Allah. When I was in school, I was taught Do-O-Do, Do-O-Do, Do-O-Do is what? Not go, it is go. I was taught beauty but, beauty cut, N-U-T nut, beauty, not put, but. I said, what sort of a language is this? He said, no, you have to say beauty but, not but. And if I have to pass the examination, even I say beauty but. Geo is not go, it is go. I have to, because it's their language. Similarly, we know how to pronounce correctly Allah. They say Allah, he said, no problem. The right pronunciation is Allah. Later on, when Reverend Scofield realized what he had done, that he is coming closer to the Quran, maybe people took objection. In the revised edition, that thing is taken out. A-L-A-H is taken out. So now when you get the Scofield English Bible, only E-L and E-L-A-H is there. A-L-A-H is not there. But in spite of that, yet, Alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in every Bible, yet, the name of Allah is there. Because, according to the Bible, when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, actually he was crucified, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 27, verse number 46, as well as the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 15, verse number 34, when he was put on the cross, he cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. So as to say, O God, why hast thou forsaken me? If you analyze and ask them, that what is Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? It's a Hebrew quotation. But it has been maintained. Even in the English Bible, it has been maintained. And then they translate, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. O God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some people say the name of God is Jehovah. So I asked them, does Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani sound like Joha, Joha, why has thou forsaken me? They say no. Does it sound like Jesus, Jesus, peace be upon him, why has thou forsaken me? They say no. Hebrew and Arabic language are sister languages. If you translate Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani into Arabic, it is Allah, Allah, lama taraktani. Does it sound similar? Yes. Why? Sister language. And the best part of it is that the Bible has been translated into more than 2,000 different languages. And in every language, this quotation is verbatim the same. Allah, Allah, lama sabachthani. Whether it's a Tamil Bible, Chinese Bible, Hebrew Bible, any Bible, this Hebrew quotation has been maintained and the word Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there in each and every translation of the Bible. This word Allah, like Guru Nanak, one of the attributes he gave to God is Rahim. Also he gave Allah. If you read the Hindu scripture Upanishad, one of the Upanishads is called as the Allah Upanishad. And God Almighty has called by Allah several times. even in Rig Veda, even if you read the Rig Veda, the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the attributes, is given in book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 11, the name, one of the attributes of God Almighty is Allah. They write it as I-L-A. But when you pronounce it, we have to tell them, pronounce it as Allah. Hope they answer the question.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Haji Muhammad. Brother Zakir, you mentioned in your talk that Jesus never claimed divinity. But it is mentioned in the Bible that Jesus said, I and my Father are one. Does this not imply that he claimed divinity?
Brother asked the question that I said in my talk, that nowhere does the Bible say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, claimed divinity. And he gave a quotation of the Bible that Jesus said, I and my Father are one. What the brother is quoting is a verse from the Bible in the Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 30, which does say, I and my Father are one. But when you ask the Christian missionaries that what is the context, I have not yet met a Christian missionary who can tell you the context without opening the Bible. He knows I and my Father are one, but he doesn't know the context. For example, if I quote to someone that the Quran says do not pray, most of the Muslims will be shocked. What am I talking? And if you open it, does say do not pray, but it's half the verse. Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 43 says, do not pray with your mind before. Do not pray when you're intoxicated. So if I only quote do not pray, it will mean Quran says don't pray. Half the quotation. So for context, I and my Father are one, you have to go to Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 23, and I'm quoting from my memory, that Jesus walked into the temple in Solomon's porch, verse number 24. It says, and the Jews came around him and asked him, how long dost thou make us doubt? If thou art the Christ, tell us plainly. Verse number 25 says, I told you, but you believe me not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. Verse number 26 says, that you believe not, because you are not my sheep, as I said unto you. The Jews, they were asking Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, that why don't you speak plainly? So he tells them that, yes, I am the Messiah. I've told you clearly, but because you're not my sheep, you don't believe in me. Verse number 27 continues. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, continues saying that my sheep, they hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Verse 28, that I give them eternal life, no man can pluck them out of my hand, and they shall not perish. Verse number 29 says, my Father who giveth to me, he is greater than all. No man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. Then verse number 30 says, I and my Father are one. Any person who has little bit sense can make out, I and my Father are one, doesn't mean one as one person. It means one in purpose. Verse number 28 says, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, saying, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Verse 29 is saying, no man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. Verse number 30 says, I and my Father are one. In purpose, both Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Almighty God, they are one in purpose. If I say that my father is a doctor and he is a doctor, alhamdulillah, even I am a doctor. If I say I and my Father are one, what does it mean? It means one in purpose. As medical profession, my father is a doctor, even I am a doctor. It doesn't mean that I and my Father are one. It means my father is a medical doctor, even I am a medical doctor. But Christians say, no, it means one, actual unity. So we say, okay, you say actual unity, let's read further. If you go ahead in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 21, it says that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that he, all of them are one. My Father in me and I in thee, we all are one. Does it mean that God Almighty is in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ is in all his 12 disciples? So there will be 14 gods. Jesus Christ, God Almighty and 12 disciples. The same one is used there and here. If you go to the source, the same word is used. If you go to the Greek, same word is used. So does it mean you'll have 14 gods? And among those disciples, Judas was a traitor. Even he's God. Thomas doubted Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Is he God? Peter, Jesus Christ says, he's satanic. Is he also God? No, all of them, God Almighty, Jesus Christ and the Apostle, are one in purpose. They are same. Again, if you go 2 verses ahead, Gospel of John, chapter 17, verse 23 says that I am in thee and you and me, he tells the disciples. Does it make all of them God? No, it means one in purpose. But then Christian will say, okay, I have quoted the first part. Why don't you quote after that? After verse number 30, Gospel of John, chapter 10. Let's go ahead. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 31 says, and Jews picked up stones again to stone at Jesus, peace be upon him. Verse number 32 says, and Jesus, peace be upon him, asked them, for which of the good works of my Father do you stone me? Verse 33 says, that we don't stone you for any good work, but because you blaspheme, being a man, call yourself God, that's why we stone you. Verbatim. I'm reading from my memory. Any person who wants to check up, can check up. It's there in the Bible. Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 23 onwards, I'm quoting. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, gives the answer. The Jews say that, see, he is trying to blaspheme calling himself God. Good riddance, they want to kill him. Good riddance. The Christians say, oh, the Jews called him God Almighty. See, they understood him correctly for redemption. One wants for redemption, they're calling him God. The other group of people for good riddance. But the answer is given in the next verse. Verse number 34 of John chapter 10, Gospel of John chapter 10, says that, is it not mentioned in your scriptures that ye are God? And if the person to whom the word of God came, if he says God, the scripture is not broken. If you check up in the Bible, in the Psalm chapter number 82, verse number 6 does say that ye are God. So Jesus Christ gave the answer that the person to whom the word of God came, if you call him God, it is not blaspheme. It is meaning that they are one in purpose. Hope that answers the question.
Now we would allow one question on the slip and one on the mic in continuing in the clockwise rotation so that we give an opportunity for the people who have taken the trouble to write the question on the slip. One question on the slip, then on the mic, again on the slip, then on the mic, again on the slip and on the mic. The question is, when all believe in one God, why people fight in the name of God and in the name of religion?
The person asked the question that if all the people, all the human beings, or most of them, believe in one God, believe in one type of religion, why do they fight? Why are there so much of infighting, riots, etc.? No religion, which I know of, tells that people should fight with each other unnecessarily. No religion says that. Neither the Quran, neither the Veda, neither the Bible, unnecessarily should not. And the Holy Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, if anyone kills any human being, unless it be for murder or creating mischief in the land, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. Quran does not say if you kill a Muslim, you have killed the whole of humanity. If you kill any human being, unless it be for murder or creating mischief in the land, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. So no religion teaches that people should fight with each other unnecessarily. Suppose people are trying to oppress you, then most of the religion says that you should put that oppressor back in its place. Quran says that, Surah Anfal, Surah Tawbah, that if the people try to drive you out of your house, out of your faith, out of your land, then you can fight them for self-defense. Even the Gita, the whole Bhagavad Gita, it is known as the nectar of the Vedas. Lord Krishna, he is giving advice to Arjun that see, you fight for the truth. Even if the opposite people are relatives, don't stop. If they are in the wrong, you fight. The Quran says in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse 81, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقِّ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ قَانَ زَهُوكَ وَنَزُّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنَ مَا وَشِفَاءُ رَحْمَةُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزُلْمِينَ لَا خَسَارًا. That when truth is heard against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. The Quran is a healing and mercy for those who believe. It was revealed in stages. But for those who are unbelievers, it's nothing but loss after loss. So basically, no religion tells you to fight, unless in self-defense. Even the police kills the robber in self-defense, kills the criminal. But normally, under normal circumstances, people should not fight. But yet I do know that people fight. Why is the big question. You know what the reason? The reason is people fight for power, for material things. The politician, he wants vote. What does he do? He instigates a riot. A riot. And then you get marginalized. And then Hindus vote Hindu, Muslim vote Muslim. Politicians. If a builder wants a land, you can't acquire the land because there are 1,000 huts there. What does he do? He instigates a riot on the base of religion. The huts are burned down and then he builds a big building on that land for money. So these people, for power, for money, for material requirements, these people, they instigate the riots. Otherwise, the common Hindu, the common Muslim, alhamdulillah, we love each other. We love our non-Muslim brother. Bombay, if you know Bombay, even during partition, there was not such a riot as we had a couple of years ago. Engineered by whom? Politicians. Politicians engineered it. All because for power, for material desires. Otherwise, no religion says that we should fight with one another. We do know. We have similarities. We agree with that. We have differences also. But a politician, on the front of everyone, he'll say, Ram bhi khuda, Allah bhi khuda. Front of it. And behind he goes an engineer's right. See, we don't believe in pseudo-secularism. If suppose two people are there, one person is saying 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. The other person is saying 2 plus 2 is equal to 5. That does not mean, oh, he's such a good man. 2 plus 2 is also equal to 4. 2 plus 2 is also equal to 5. I am a very deshbhakt, secular person. What secular? Hypocrisy. I should have the guts to say, see, what you are saying 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 is right. What you are saying 2 plus 2 is 5 is wrong, but I will not fight with you. I will tell you the truth, I will not fight with you. Then the Quran says in Surah Kafirun, chapter 109, verse number 1 to 6. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينِ. Say to those who reject faith, I will not worship what you worship, nor will you worship what I worship. I will not be worshipping that which you want me to worship, nor will you worship what I worship. To you is your way, to me is mine. To yours, your religion, to me is mine. I will present the truth to him. Why? Don't do idol worship. Don't have wrong concept of God. Yet if you have, lakum dinukum waliya din. To you is your way, to me is mine. The Holy Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 256. La ikraha fid din. There is no compulsion in religion. Truth stands out clear from error. If you hold the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will take you from darkness to light. If you hold the hand of the evil one, the devil, He will take you from light to darkness. The choice is yours. But no religion says that you should fight with each other unnecessarily. Hope that answers the question.
My name is Sushil Karamkutkar, official photographer, All India Radio, Vivid Bharati Service and Bombay Doordarshan Kendra. I have visited holy country of Islam, that is Saudi Arabia, 3 times and spent nearly 4 years in Saudi Arabia and watch Islam from closer distance. Now, Dr. Zakir Naik, my question is, there is a Muslim blind person. His one eye is replaced by eye donated by a Hindu person. His kidney, one kidney is replaced by kidney donated by a Christian person. And his heart is replaced by heart donated by Parsi gentleman. Such a Muslim person will be allowed to perform prayers in the mosque?
The brother asked a question that he has been to Saudi Arabia and one person is eyes from a Hindu or heart from a Christian and kidney from so and so, various things. So having eye from another religion, heart from another religion, can you offer salah in the mosque? The answer is, brother, according to Islam, every human being is born as a Muslim. Every heart is a Muslim. Every kidney is a Muslim. Every eye is a Muslim. What is the meaning of Muslim? Muslim is the person who submits the will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every heart submits the will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm talking about the organic heart. Organic heart, no? Organic heart, it pumps blood. The heart of the Christian pumps blood. The heart of a Muslim pumps blood. The heart of a Hindu pumps blood. The heart is a Muslim. Talking about the organic heart. I, the organic I, is a Muslim. But you see wrong things. I'm sorry, I'm not telling you. You mean you. The human being sees wrong things. The human being is to blame. But the eye sees. The eye is following the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The kidney, it's doing its job. It's purifying. It's a Muslim. So whether heart taken from a person who's born in a Hindu family or Christian family, every heart is a Muslim, every eye is a Muslim, every kidney is a Muslim, he will be very well allowed to play in a mosque. But even if a non-Muslim wants to come to the mosque, he's most welcome. Our beloved prophet, he has discussion about concept of God. Time didn't permit me, the revelation of Surah Ikhlas, the touchstone of theology, which I gave to everyone, was revealed when? When he was having a discussion with the Christians in the mosque. And they asked him, who is Allah? What can you think? The Quran says you convert all the trees into pens, all the ocean into ink. What will he say, Rahman, Rahim? What answer can he give? The direct revelation came. Kul, tell them. Kul hu Allahu ahad. Say he is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him.
Assalamu alaikum. Dr. Brother Zakir Naik, my question is regarding the form of Allah. Surah number 39, Zumar, verse 67. The translation says that, and on the day of resurrection, the whole of the earth will be grasped by his hand, and the heavens will be rolled up in his right hand. There is also an hadith in support of this, Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 6, hadith number 336. Can we just imagine some form of Allah?
The sister asked a question, and Surah Al-Zumur, it says, she's correct, Quran does say that, that on the day of judgment and resurrection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold all the creation and various verses in the Quran, etc. But if you heard my talk, sister, I gave you the key word. The key to this concept is Surah Ash-Shura, chapter 42, verse number 11, which says, Laisa kamislihi shay. There is nothing whatever like him. So if Quran says Allah has hands, people ask me that the Quran says Allah holds the sky. What do you mean he holds like that? If I say I am holding my family together, do you mean to say 24 hours I am with my wife and my child? I'm not holding my wife and child always. Yet I'm holding them, but I'm not holding them like that. These are words used. And whenever, as I said, if Quran says Allah sees and hears, you owe that man Allah is here like us. He hears. How he hears? Allah alam. Allah knows. He has a hand, but not like yours and mine. Five fingers. With nails. And with this. Not like that. He has a hand? Yes, he has a hand. How he has a hand? Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him. How will he do it? Allahu alam. He will do it for sure. Quran says he rolled in the right hand. He will hold it in the right hand. How he'll hold it with five fingers or six fingers, I don't know. On the day of judgment, inshallah, you and I will witness that.
The next question from the slip. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Zakir. As Muslims, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Noor. We cannot attribute any form or gender to him. Why then, when we speak of Almighty God, or as written in the Holy Quran, Allah is always referred to as He, a sister?
The sister has asked a very good question, and this question had troubled me for several years. And she asked the question, Allah is Noor, He has got no form, no gender. So why is it written as Hua, as He? And this question asked to various people, you know, in India and other scholars, but never got a satisfactory reply. Then I myself did a little research and then I checked it up with the experts. But when I learned Arabic, the Arabic grammar has got only two genders, male and female. English language, three gender, male, female, neuter. So if we translate Hua into English, it can be translated as he or as it. Either he or it. Same as hiya. If you translate into English, it can be translated as she or it. That's Arabic language, two genders. English language, three genders. So Hua, if you translate, you can translate he or it. Hiya as she or it. So Hua, in English, if you say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond any gender. So why have used he? Some people may say that if Hua means he and it, and hiya means she and it, both means it, So why did Allah use huwa and not here? Because Quran says, Qul huwallahu ahad. Say, He is Allah one and only. When I learned in grammar, in Arabic grammar, I was told that in the Arabic grammar, there are certain rules and criteria for feminine gender. Feminine gender. First, if it is feminine in nature, like mother, ummun, it becomes a feminine gender. Second rule, if it ends with ta, it is feminine gender. Like mirwahatun, fan, ending with ta, it becomes feminine gender. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a female, so it can't be feminine. It is not ending with ta, is it ending with ta? No, so can't be feminine. Third is, it should end with bala alif, then becomes feminine. Allah doesn't end with bala alif, so it can't become feminine. And another one is that pairs of the body, tools, like eyes, ainun, feminine, yadun, hand, feminine. Allah is kul huwallahu ahad, say Allah one and only, it's not pair. So therefore, in defection, in default, since it can't be used as hiya it, that she it, Allah uses huwa it. Otherwise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got no gender at all.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. Brother, my name is Ali Hussain. Now, in your talk, you have mentioned that, and even in your earlier talk, which I have heard, you have mentioned that Jesus in Bible is nowhere claiming divinity. Now, I had gone through a booklet which was propagating Christianity and implying that all the sufferings are healed by Jesus, peace be upon him. And it gave the reference that Jesus is saying, I am the Lord who heals you. And the reference was from Exodus chapter number 15, verse number 26. And even it went further, saying that in 1 John chapter number 1, verse number 7, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sins. Now my emphasis on the first reference, where he's saying that I am the Lord who heals you. Now doesn't this imply or doesn't this indicate that Jesus is claiming divinity?
The brother is quoting Exodus chapter number 15.
Verse number 26.
Verse 26 and saying, Jesus said that I healed you. Brother, Exodus is a part of the Old Testament. Old Testament. Jesus Christ never spoke in Exodus. Never. I said in my talk, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the whole Bible where Jesus, peace be upon him, himself says that he's God, worship me. This is the Bible I have got by the Christians, King James Version. Everything what Jesus Christ spoke is in red. To check it up, this will never be in red. It is not the words of Jesus, it is word of somebody else. And even if I agree with you, for sake of argument, that Jesus did say that he healed, and the Quran does agree with that, and I said in my talk, we believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. He healed those born and blind with God's permission. So I've got no objection in agreeing that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did heal the people. It's our faith, even we believe in it. But whatever he did, as the Bible says in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28, he cast out devil by the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20, with the finger of God he cast out devil. He did everything which bore witness of the Father. So I've got no objection in agreeing that Jesus did do miracles. But regarding Exodus, it's not the word of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Even if it is, I've got no objection. Because whatever miracles he did, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that this is done by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 24, verse number 24, for there shall arise many false Christs and false prophets. And if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Miracle is not the test. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 11, verse number 11, of those that are born of a woman, the greatest person is John the Baptist. Those that are born of a woman, the greatest person is John the Baptist. That means he was greater even than Jesus, peace be upon him, because Jesus was born to Mother Mary. So amongst all born of a woman, the greatest is John the Baptist according to Jesus, peace be upon him. Which miracle did he do? Not a single. Therefore, miracle is not the criteria to make him God. Hope that's all.